Hello, my name is Lydia Messerschmidt and I'm Artifact Conservator at National Museum Scotland. At the moment, I'm finalising the conservation of an object which will be displayed in the Legacies of Empire exhibition up in the War Museum in the Edinburgh Castle. So the opening will be the 27th of November, so when you're around, have a look. The object is a large drinking horn, which had been taken by James Brood of Kinnaird in 1772. Bruce was a Scottish traveller and travel writer who spent more than 12 years in North Africa to trace the origin of the Nile. We have already two other objects from James Bruce in our collection, and this object is just a wonderful addition and enrichment to this assembly. We know from James Bruce's colourful travel report that the horn must have been in a good condition when he took it. And later it got passed on to the Falkenberg Regiment, where it got changed to serve as a bugle horn. Additionally, a silver-plated plaque had been added, which gives more information about the origin of the horn. After the regiment had been disbanded, the whereabouts of the horn are unknown. It appears again 250 years later, but unfortunately in a very bad condition. It was broken into two pieces which had been formerly mended with bandages. On the basis of these bandages and on newspaper fragments found inside the horn, we can say that the horn had been mended around 100 years ago. With time, these bandages deteriorated, which led to splits and a renewed separation of both pieces. When I took on the task to conserve this horn, I could not assess the condition of the horn properly because of the bandages covering up these damages. So my first task was to remove these bandages. The bandages are part of the history of the horn, and I wanted to document them and their position as good as possible. I decided to take a time-lapse video of the unraveling process, as it allows to retrace where each layer of fabric was located and had been applied. At the same time, this form of documentation helped me to keep my hands free to actually carry out the task. I used this documentation technique throughout the conservation process, as it is also a fantastic medium to be used in social media and to bring conservation alive. During the process, I could see that three different types of fabric had been applied and were secured with protein-based glue. After their removal, the full extent of the damage was revealed. The condition was truly horrifying. Large fragments of the horn material are missing and long cracks are extending from the break edges. The damaged areas are extremely deformed and the horn material is delaminating along the break edges and on the internal surface. Additionally, this inner surface of the horn is heavily soiled with encrusted layers of dirt, which served partially as a breeding ground for pests. On the outer surface, a varnish had been applied shortly after the horn was wrapped in bandages. This varnish has darkened over time and was obscuring the original color of the drinking horn. With the fast approaching deadline of the exhibition, I found the task slightly overwhelming and wondered if I'd be successful in mending both pieces back together and can bring the horn into a presentable state. But there's a saying, strength is born from calmness, and so I worked my way steadily through the tasks. The first step was to clean all surfaces to remove dirt, soiling, or varnish, and an old repair. I started in the usual approach with cotton swabs, but noticed very quickly that this won't bring me far, as the surfaces were extremely dirty. I swapped the swab for a toothbrush, which worked already much better, but had still not the impact on the encrusted dirt as I hoped. In the end, I moved the horn to our sink and used the biggest brush I could find while rinsing the interior regularly with deionized water. Black water ran out on the other end. When the water started to become clear, I used a toothbrush to address the dirt in crevices and between the laminating layers. This procedure cut the cleaning time from possible 2 months to 4 hours. while the horn was about to dry and the horn material was still flexible, I started the reshaping and stabilization process. For the stabilization of the delaminating areas and cracks, I applied animal glue. Along the break edges, I applied clamps to press the delaminating layers tightly back together while the adhesive was drying overnight. On the inside of the horn, I referred to the Japanese shimbari technique. Bamboo skewers are inserted under light tension to push down consolidated layers. In all areas, I used a thick layer of a PVC pad as interlayer between clamps and skewers. The material is slightly flexible and follows the shape of the horn, but is rigid enough to distribute the pressure of the clamp or skewer evenly onto the surface. For the reshaping of the horn, I used various materials. Jubilee clamps helped me to support the round shape of the horn in the area where the cracks were ending. Lightweight C clamps with a deep throat were specifically useful while mending long cracks. In some cases, I used 4 to 5 of these clamps in a row. Another helpful tool are these wooden blocks. I cut concave and convex blocks with the same curve of the horn. The blocks served as molds to push deformed material back into position. These were especially helpful in areas where material had been squished inwards. The blocks lifted the material evenly and helped me to compress delaminating areas at the same time. Further on, the plain sides of the blocks allowed me to apply clamps without them sliding off the curved surface of the horn. After 2 months of reshaping, I decided to stop, even when there were still a few areas which were not perfectly aligned. But my attempts to ease these further did not achieve any changes. I had to accept that this is the best possible result I can achieve with the limited time I have. The next step was to mend both pieces back together. I was thinking for months about the step while I was still busy with cleaning and reshaping. I wanted to build an inner structural support which is rigid enough to support the reshaped material and to hold both pieces together. I knew that the last point would be not easy to achieve as there is just a very small connection area between both pieces. Thankfully, such material exists in the form of X-Lite. X-Lite is a thermoplast in the form of a mesh which is used in the medical sector to support broken extremities. It can be softened in a hot water bath or with a heat spatula and molded into place. As soon as it cools down, it becomes very rigid. This rigidity is increased by applying multiple layers on top of each other. I cut handy segments and applied them onto the inner surface of the horn. Started in the area with the least damage and worked my way outward to the break edges. The material is so strong that it even held a section of horn material in place, which was still under tension and would have collapsed again if it would have not been held open by clamps. In all other areas, I let the horn do its will, but this section was key to mending both pieces back together, as it is their only area of contact. It was very satisfying to see the structural support filling out and starting to bridge areas of loss. The moment both pieces came back together and were successfully bonded with X-Lite was definitely the highlight of this conservation project. Till to that point, I was not sure if it would work as I have hoped. The last step was to close the window in the X-Lite, which I had to do from inside. The only access was the opening of the horn, which was 60 centimeters away. I reached the area with the heat spatula just about, but could not see from this position what I was doing. Therefore, I used an endoscope camera to transfer the live image of the section onto a screen. So I'm now at the final stage of the conservation process. And as you can see here, I covered the X-Lite with dyed Japanese tissue to have like an even surface where I can build on my fill. For the fill, I'm using Biva film, which I'm melting on a hot plate and then mixing in pure raw pigments, dry pigments, range from yellow ochre to raw umber. And then I'm creating these discs in this way, which I then cut and mix certain ratios together to create various shades of brown and yellow. And then I'm using some of this cut off and just melting it. So then I take a piece of my colored beaver and melting it with the hot spatula directly in place. You can see it well melts really nicely and it becomes really soft, and it feels like retouching with different colors.